She was literally caught in the act of sinning. And the encounter that took place from that situation changed everything today. I just want to ask you to join me in a word of prayer. Father, we love you. And God, today as we spend some time in your word, I pray that it will change us. God, from the depths of our souls, God, may it change us. May it make us different. God, may we have a realization that this easily could be one of us. Father, we love you. We thank you so much for Jesus and the hope that we have because of him. May your words change our hearts, our minds, our actions, and our attitudes so that we can look like you. We love you. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. If you have your Bibles, I want to encourage you to open up to John chapter 8. If you don't have your Bibles, it'll be up here on the screen. Or if you have your smart devices, you can look under the YouVersion app and you can find the notes right there, okay? This is, again, one of the most familiar stories that we've heard. And I think sometimes it's because people want to use it in its wrong context. So today we're going to look at this story, and I hope that it changes your perspective about what sin looks like through the eyes of Jesus, okay? So we pick up in John chapter 8, starting in verse 1. But Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. Early in the morning, he came again to the temple. And all the people came to him, and he sat down, and he taught them. So here's what's happened. I want to give you a little context about what's going on here. The Jewish people, the Israelites, they had just finished the Feast of Tabernacles. And the Feast of Tabernacles lasts 7 days. On the eighth day, they gather together and they have what is called the solemn assembly. They gather together in the temple courts and they have a solemn assembly of those who have stayed a little bit longer after the Feast of Tabernacles. They have teaching and Jesus was there. Jesus was in the courtyard of women. Now, let me explain this for a minute. In Old Testament times, in biblical times, there was a courtyard of women, and there was also the courtyard of men. The courtyard of men, can you guess who was allowed in the courtyard of men? Anybody got any ideas? Just men. Okay? But do you know who was allowed in the courtyard of women? Anybody. Anybody. Not just women. Anybody. So Jesus was teaching in the courtyard of women. Well, why do you think that is? Well, maybe it's because Jesus, just a chapter or two before, had begun to teach us a lesson. That what he was bringing was not only for just the religious elite, it was not just for men, it was not just for the Pharisees. This new thing that Jesus was bringing was for anyone. And so Jesus is teaching in the courtyard of women. Anyone could be there to listen. No one would be excluded from hearing his teaching. And the truth of the matter is this. Jesus wanted his message of love and grace to be heard by everyone that was there. So we pick up in verse 3. This is what it says. The scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in adultery. And placing her in the midst, they said to him, "Teacher, this woman has been caught in the act of adultery. Now the law of Moses commanded us to stone such women. So what do you say?" Now, let me just ask you a question. To me, when I read this story, this seems a little fishy. Does this seem a little weird to you? I mean, correct me if I'm wrong. I mean, they catch this woman in the act of adultery. Okay. But the last time I checked, it takes two to tango, right? I mean, a woman can't be caught in the act of adultery by herself. Right? Am I right? Or am I confused? So where's the dude? Where's the man? Where's the guy that was also, obviously, must have been caught in the act of adultery as well? Where is he? Well, he's nowhere to be found. But here's the thing. The thing is these Pharisees, they knew the law. In fact, if it were true that this woman and this man were caught in the act of adultery, they were just following what the Old Testament law said. Leviticus chapter 20, verse 10 says this: if a man commits adultery with the wife of his neighbor, both the adulterer and the adulteress shall surely be put to death. Again, man and woman there, right? There's two people, okay? Deuteronomy 22:22 says, if a man is found lying with the wife of another man, both of them shall die. The man who lay with the woman and the woman. So you shall purge the evil from Israel. God didn't play around when it came to sin. I mean, and those of you who've been doing your reading 90 days through the Bible, we looked at the Old Testament. We've been looking at the Old Testament. God didn't play around. God didn't play games when it came to sin. God made it pretty simple. If you sin, you're out. And in this instance, if you sin, you're dead. If you're caught in the act of adultery, you're done. I'm going to murder you. There's another aside I just want to tell you here. But also in the Old Testament, it says that children, if you're disobedient to your parents to the point that you will never listen to them, you know what it says to do? It says to take them outside the camp and kill them because they're going to ruin the camp. Aren't you glad that doesn't happen today, children? Yeah. So the Pharisees were just following the rules, right? I mean, if you look at it in these terms, see, Jesus hadn't yet come and brought the new covenant. He was in the process of bringing the new covenant, but the new covenant had not been established yet because he hadn't died on the cross. So the Pharisees just thought, hey man, we're just doing what the Bible says. We're just trying to live up to the rules. Let's read verse 6. It says this: this they said to test him, that they might have some charge to bring against him. But Jesus bent down and wrote with his finger on the ground. Well, now we see that this was a setup, right? I mean, it says it right there. This was a test. They wanted to get an answer from him. Why do you think it was so important to get an answer from him? You see, Jesus, just a few short days ago, they tried to arrest him for teaching that he was the Messiah. If you turn back just one page in your Bibles to chapter 7 of John, we see Jesus being confronted by the Pharisees, and they literally are trying to get him into a position where they could kill him. Because they're saying, you're saying you're the Messiah, that's blasphemy, and that means you should be put to death. But Jesus gets away. He walks away because he's God. But it didn't work, you see. So the Pharisees had to come up with another way to try and discredit him. Here's the thing. Jesus, this entire time, had been teaching this idea of love and mercy and grace and how everyone could be part of the kingdom. And so the Pharisees think they've got him caught. Because the truth of the matter is this: if Jesus comes and he says, yes, put her to death, then this idea of love and mercy and grace that Jesus has been teaching and preaching is now thrown away. He is no longer that guy. But there's another piece to this where they're going to try and trap him too. See, they could arrest him for breaking Roman law. And Roman law says that no one can put anybody to death but the Roman government. So if Jesus says yes, the Romans are going to bust him. If he says yes, he throws this idea a way that he is full of love, mercy, and grace. But if he says no, then he's blaspheming against the word of God. So they had him trapped, right? I mean, if you're looking at it from a worldly perspective, if you're looking at it from a man's eye, he's busted. There's nothing he can do. So Jesus stoops down, and he begins to write in the dirt. There's been a lot of conjecture in many, many, many years about what Jesus was writing. You ever thought that? I mean, when he stooped down in the dirt, what was Jesus writing? I don't know. But I think that we have something that we can gain some understanding from by one of the words that's used here in this text. The word right. The word right, this is going to be appearing on your screen. The word right is katagraphion. It's Greek. That's the word that's used there. It says to write against or to write a record of someone. Okay? So Jesus stoops down after these dudes say, "Hey, what should we do?" And he stoops down and begins to write. To all these people that are standing around, you got this Pharisee standing around, you got this woman over here on the ground, probably partially clothed because they just grabbed her up and brought her in front of Jesus. She's on the ground. I can just only imagine what she's thinking right now. That in this moment, she will die. So Jesus stoops and he begins to write a record of someone, to write against someone. Literally, I believe after reading this and understanding this, I believe Jesus was probably writing down some things about these men that brought this woman. Because we don't write a record against someone unless we got something to write, correct? So Jesus is stooped down on the ground and he's writing. And you know, a lot of times we don't understand exactly what he was writing, but I think if we just look at the text here, we can get a pretty good understanding. So if we look at John 8, 7 through 8, it says this, "And as they continued to ask them, he stood up and said to them, 'Let him who is without sin among you be the first to throw a stone at her.' And once more, he bent down and he wrote on the ground." See, Jesus takes a moment and he answers them. He bases his answer in an Old Testament command. Again, I love how Jesus always went right to God's word when he was trying to attack the Pharisees, because he was trying to teach them something. Listen to what he says in Deuteronomy 17:7. "The hand of the witness shall be first against him put to death," or against him to put him to death, "and afterward the hand of all the people. So you shall purge the evil from your midst." He is saying, listen, if you saw it, you kill her. If you saw her committing this act, then you throw the first stone. That's what the Bible says. In Deuteronomy, there's also a command that says if there is an accuser that has caught the person, but they are a false accuser, they are to be put to death. So in other words, what Jesus is saying is, listen, if you saw her do it, then you throw the first stone. If you didn't, and you're accusing her falsely, then guess what's coming for you? Jesus wasn't playing around. So Jesus is saying, if you're falsely accusing her, you should be stoned. But he takes it further than that. This idea where he says, "for you who are without sin," the Greek word there is anamartitos, okay? And it means without a sinful desire to do the same. Jesus says to them, if any of you standing in my midst right now that's making an accusation against this lady, if any of you have not sinned with the same desire, then you throw the first stone. If any of you have never felt the sting of lust hit your eyes and know that it's wrong, or looked a second too long, or kept that image just a little too long, if any of you have never done that, then you throw the first stone. See, Jesus was referring back to what he said in Matthew chapter 5 when he says this, "You've heard that it was said, 'You shall not commit adultery.' But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lustful intent has already committed adultery with her in his heart." And so Jesus is asking them a question. Are you guilty too? Are you guilty too? Jesus was trying to show them that they were just as guilty. That they had just been caught too. George Whitefield, who's a great theologian, in all his humility says this, There but for the grace of God go I. See, the truth of the matter is this. Any of us could be caught in the same situation. See, we talked last week about this idea that if there was one sin that I don't want anybody to know about, if there was one thing that I don't want anybody to know about, it would be this. You think this woman had those same feelings? If there was one thing that I don't want anybody to know about me, it's this. But don't you think the Pharisees probably could have said the same thing? If there was one thing that I wish nobody knew about me, it's that I wish I didn't have lustful thoughts. And Jesus calls them on the carpet. These men had not been humbled, but Jesus humbled them. So we read verses 9 through 11, and this is what it says. But when they heard it, when they heard Jesus say, "You who haven't had the same sinful thought, cast the first stone." When they heard it, they went away one by one, beginning with the older ones, and Jesus was left alone with the woman standing before him. Jesus stood up to her and said, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" She said, "No one, Lord." And Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go. And from now on, don't sin anymore." See, the truth is these men wanted her dead. They wanted to see her bloodied and destroyed in front of everyone. You ever caught yourself being harder on someone that struggles with the same sin you struggle with? I mean, have you ever gotten mad at somebody because of gossip, yet you're really good at it too? Have you ever been frustrated with someone because of anger, but you struggle with it too? And what's your thing? What's your sin? I mean, for these men, they were trying to condemn someone for a sin that they themselves had ultimately struggled with too. I want you to remember a truth. Jesus is a redeemer and a reclaimer. And Jesus offers not the grave, but grace. See, these men wanted to offer this lady the grave. They wanted her dead. But Jesus wanted to reclaim this woman's life. He wanted to reclaim her from the grave. And he wanted to say, "From this point forward, I extend you grace." But what he doesn't do is he doesn't say, "I'm going to reclaim you from the grave and I'm going to extend you grace. Now have a good day." No, he says, I'm going to reclaim you from the grave and I'm going to offer you a grace, but don't do it anymore. Stop. Because that's not who you are. Can't you just see it? Can't you just see that picture when Jesus looks her in the eyes and he says, "Don't go sin anymore, please, because this is not who I made you to be. I made you to be loved. I made you to be accepted. I made you in my image." Jesus came to offer the gospel to her, the good news, and know this morning, church, that the gospel is all about second chances. It's all about second chances and third chances and fourth chances and fifth chances and sixth chances and seventh chances. Because I'm here to tell you today, if you think you're only going to screw up one time in your life, think again. The gospel is about second chances. think about something for a minute. These men came and accused this woman. I want to ask you this question. Who is your accuser? Who's your accuser? We have people in our lives that come and they accuse us of things. I know we've all dealt with it. You've probably had someone say that you're not nice, or that you're this or that or the other. You have people that say those things about you. But the truth is, the biggest problem we often have in our own lives is ourselves. We are our own best accusers. We say things like, I'm not worthy. I'm not good enough. This is who I will always be. We accuse ourselves. If you're to look back over your life, is there anyone who is as good an accuser of you than you? My guess is probably not. We all too often condemn ourselves before anyone else has the opportunity to do so. And the thing is we do something that if we were stuck in biblical times, we do something that we would think was foolish if we saw someone else doing it. You know what we do? We bring our own rocks to the stoning. We bring our own rocks. We come with a pile of rocks. And we say, you know what? You lust. You hate. You're bitter. You're angry. You're a glutton. You're stuck in your addiction. And we hand out our rocks as people come to prepare to stone us. And they come and they hurl stones in agreement. And while we point the finger at ourselves, we give the ammunition for others to do the same. We're so good at pointing fingers. We're so good at pointing fingers when others do what we believe to be wrong. But here's the truth for you this morning, church. We need to quit pointing fingers. We need to start raising hands. I heard a story recently of a church that had just started. And one of the things this church wanted to be about was they wanted to be about loving messy people. They wanted to be a church that was about loving people in the midst of their sin, loving people through their sin, and helping them to overcome their sin. A lot like Celebrate Recovery is here at our church. And so Kyle Eidelman, who's a preacher at Southeast Christian Church in Louisville, Kentucky, shared a story. And he says, I went to this church and they invited me to come to this gathering that they had. And when I got there, it seemed a little strange because there was a big circle set up in the room. And there was a bunch of people sitting in these chairs. And there was a man that was sitting there. The leader of the group was there. And I began to get engaged with what was going on. And he said, so this man sits down or stands up. And he says this. He says, so guys, I screwed up. He said, I've been doing so good with my lustful thoughts, but I made a mistake. And he said, so I was on my way home from work. And I stopped by the ATM and I grabbed some money. Then I went by the convenience store and got some $1 bills. And a guy's hand goes up. So Kyle says he sat there. And the guy continued to share the story. And he said, I drove down to the local strip club. And I sat in my car and I debated with myself, should I go in? And another hand goes up. And he said that I couldn't overcome what was going on in my heart. So he said, I went inside and I spent every dime that I had. 2, 3, 4, 5 hands go up. So they get done with the night. Kyle walks up to the guy that's leading the group. And he says, so what in the world just happened here? And the guy said, oh, I'm sorry, I forgot to tell you. He said, we are not a place that encourages pointing fingers. We encourage raising hands. And Kyle said, explain this to me. And he says, whenever someone tells a story and we've done the same thing, instead of pointing a finger, we raise a hand. Because we want those people to know that they're not alone. And that the church is here to help them walk free of the struggles that they have in their life. So instead of pointing a finger, we raise a hand. So here's the bottom line today, church. We need to be a church of raised hands and forgiving hearts. We need to stop pointing fingers and start accepting others, warts and all, into the kingdom. Now, I think that if we were honest with each other, and I asked the question of myself, have I ever struggled with a lustful thought, I would raise my hand. Have I ever been angry? Have I ever been held unforgiveness and bitterness in my heart? Have I ever spewed hate? Have I ever insulted someone? Have I ever pointed a finger? See, church, the truth this morning is this. God wants us to be a church of raised hands that are willing to surrender to Him and willing to love no matter what. Because the truth is this, in Romans 8:1 it says this, therefore is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. In James chapter 2, it says, for judgment is without mercy to one who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. Church, we should be a church that triumphs mercifully over judgment. We should be a church that walks around like this all day long because we know what it's like to try and live a life where we're trying to live right, but we keep falling over. We keep failing. We keep struggling. See, the truth is this. We need to be a church that loves. And forgives. We need to be who God has truly called us to be. So the question I ask you today is very, very simple. Are you willing to raise a hand in agreement instead of pointing a finger in judgment? This morning we're going to sing this song. And I stand here before you humbled because I know there's been times where I've pointed a finger and haven't raised a hand. And if I'm honest, those pointing finger times are probably a lot more than those raised hands times. And I don't think that I'm much different than any of the rest of us in this room. I think that if we were all honest with each other, we would all realize that we've all done the same thing. God calls us to do something different. He calls us to be someone different. So this morning, we're going to sing this song. This morning, I just believe that there's people in here who need to come and repent. Because I know that I've had to this week. I believe there's people that need to come and repent and maybe come up to these stairs or come up to these chairs or come see one of us that are going to be down front. You need to come and repent because you haven't been doing what you're supposed to do. And that's loving and accepting and extending mercy and grace to those who need it. See, we can pick up a rock and throw one. But the truth is there'll probably be two or three coming back at us. So the challenge this morning is to truly, honestly, listen to the voice of the Spirit. Ask Him to change you from the inside out. We want to invite you this morning, if you have a decision to share, we want to invite you to come right now as we stand.